So, the theme of the biennial, it is a theme of biennial,
yes, right?
It's not only the seminar, is the society of spectacle. And that is, as you all know, a book by Louis Debord, French philosopher, very much rooted in the late 60s Marxist rebellious Parisian Spring. The book appeared in 67 and in 68 you had these dramatic events going on in Paris. But and it's a book about society today as a systematic sort of delusion or illusion where reality is distorted in a sort of sympathetic way in what at that time would be described as, in Marxist terms, false consciousness, which means that you have society formed of idealized images, that you need the tool of, in this instance, Marxism to have revealed for yourself, then you might see another reality. How would you, if I start with Andres, if we speak about spectacle in relationship to what you are working with, what meaning would you find in that sort of framing today from the perspective of your practice?
No, it's more a spectacle.
Sorry?
It's more a spectacle.
In a way, yes. But I think that I was thinking about it before, and I think that a lot of the things that I photograph and that we portray, specifically when we work in what has to be considered journalism, is that a lot of people are acting. I'm trying to keep it down to earth here, because, a lot of the stuff that we portray, it's a constant struggle to try to get underneath what I understand as a spectacle, to try to because everyone you're dealing with have an idea of what everything is supposed to look like. So everyone is behaving in a way, at least as soon as there's a camera present, people are behaving in a specific way, and it's very difficult to be able to get underneath that. And I think that war in itself might not be a spectacle, but the way it is seen could be. I don't know if that's an answer to the question.
Yeah, because what I'm wondering is also, isn't war actually an extreme form of distorted reality? Well, I mean, it's a reality which you die from, but it's actually a distortion of normal life, whatever normal might be, but normal life would probably be like cooking a food and being warm occasionally.
At least the portrayal of war, because the actual acts of war are usually a really small part of the war, and I think that's very interesting with what you showed in your film, that one of the things that we never get into it is that most of the... I did a big exhibition about refugees, and I tried to portray that as daily life in the refugee ship. Because you always have images of mass exodus. As soon as it's something, it's taken away from the individual, and you have it on a more symbolic, portrayed in a more symbolic way. But people keep living normal life even in wars. Even when they're refugees, the daily life is about almost the same thing as it is for us here. It's just in a different way, of course, in a more complicated way. So yes and no to that question. The part of it is a distorted way, but underneath the sort of normality is always still there.
And how about you, Nathalie? When you reflect on the theme of the biennial, which spectacle. How do you look at this, I mean, the phenomenon of spectacle from the perspective of your practice? Because that is, you enter worlds that are rather spectacular in a very intentional way. Some of these, most of these projects have been worlds that are intentionally spectacular.
I think because also a lot of my project has to do with escaping, it's the everyday life is normally not that spectacular. So I think it's important that it's made in a different way, like a lot of hotels or things like this, that it's a very different thing. But for North Korea, which is the project that is shown here, I mean the whole thing is a spectacle. From everything that I saw when I was there, apart from what I saw in between, it was all created for us and for the foreigners that are coming, and it's the same for the local people that are there. They have their own other spectacle created from them by the regime. So it feels like we're all living in very different worlds, but at the same time, it's still for everyone a spectacle. And I was reading an article about somebody who went to North Korea, and he was saying that everybody does the same thing. We all go to the same place, but he was seeing beautiful children playing balls right beside him. And he just stopped and he thought, wait, is this because we're walking by here that they put the children there? Or are the children there because they're actual children playing? And he was just confused, and he really, when he was walking away, he was looking back to actually check if the children would disappear now that they were gone. And so it feels like, you know, if it was there just for him, or if it wasn't, that was the feeling we had also when we were there. It's just everything we saw, we were like, is this just for us, or is it really the way it is? And so I think for North Korea, it's pretty much just as practical.
But on the other hand, you actually have something which you will never see, the life in the villages or the small towns that no one will enter, and where there actually is some sort of non-arranged reality as well. So,
yes, because this is what I would never see, but these people who live the unarranged reality, they also live under, they also studied things that are not real. How the war started, which it's completely a different story to what really happened in North Korea.
So it's a multi-layered spectacle.
So from every side there's a spectacle, and like for the children, we didn't know if they were or not. Same for them, maybe they don't know if it really happened this way or not. They were told that South Korea was very poor because they were taken over by the Americans, and they were living in extreme poverty. And in the 90s, bootlegs started to come out from North Korea, just from South Korea to North Korea, about TV shows. And people were confused because they were watching it and they were seeing downtown Seoul with lots of people with money and skyscrapers, and all that the government was telling them was how South Korea is living in famine and poverty. So they get glimpses of the outside, and they're starting to understand now. They know that South Korea is actually living in good condition, but that's only because they got glimpses from the outside. What's inside is not true. Yeah.
How about you, Lisa? How does the concept of how would you like to remark or give perspective to the theme of this biennial in regards to the world spectacle or the societal spectacle? How does that sort of apply from the perspective of Aleppo and Syria?
I can give you a lot from British, because British I was really following the people. I was surprised, because I had before the war in Syria, like, I really like so much respect for British media, and I was thinking that they are telling the truth. And after the war in Syria, I find out, oh my God, they are the biggest liar in the world between all the media and the British media.
Or, I don't know, in Syrian case at least, I don't understand how they fabricate all this professional
media. Include also BBC, The Guardian,
BBC is much better because of one reason, because many times when they find out they are informing wrong information, they have the courage to say, sorry, this information was not right. But like in fourth important magazine like The Guardian, The Channel Report, it's incredible. They have so much influence in the world, and people taking whatever they say is very true way, and those people, they are really incredibly creating the story. And I start in the end when I had a person who lived at the Mosul, and I start to, because this magazine, when they're telling the story about Syria, is not reaching the Syrian people. Because most of the time, last time, 72 days without internet, so we don't have internet to follow all this news. So this news making only Western activists and Western citizens angry in West. So what the benefit of this magazine to make the Western people angry? Because if all West become demonstrators, cannot change the regime in Syria. So this is something if not happening inside. The only way if the people move inside. So all this magazine and things, Syrian, they are not reading this. They are not seeing those videos. The only thing what's happening that the Western people become mad and mad every day more because of the kill, because of the news, because of the things. Of course, some of the story based on the true beginning, but how they in some of the report, it's really incredible. Like I challenged one of the American experts in Syrian case. He was in the most of the news being told. So he was informing about as the always about Aleppo city, and he visited Aleppo only 20 days. And I asked him because I'm in contact with him, so I asked him how the situation if I'm in Sweden sometime for 2 months and come back to Aleppo, the situation has changed completely. The war situation and the society grow up very fast in the world because they have war experience. So even the children, when they are 10 or 15 years old, they look like 25, 30 years old. So this is changeable society, changeable situation every week. And in the media, they talk about the fixed block stories. And this is really like incredible. Number of the people killed without chemical weapon, it's hundreds of thousands. And when the chemical weapon happened, 20 people died or 50 people died, it's become major stories. they forget that sometimes people die because the shooting in the air. It's, imagine the bullet, the sky, like raining bullet sometimes. You know? And they don't count those people. And a lot of people, we feel that sometimes they are like, they die just as number in the news, as I mentioned in the end of the movies, you know. And when I discovered all this, I tried by culture and art and all my long relation I have with a lot of organizations in the West, I tried to change that. I tried to make that, okay, we don't want to die as number in this media because they are not mentioning the truth. And they are not telling the people what is going on.
You look like Anders, I wanted to flick in.
I think you're right in a lot of what you're saying, but Syria is a very specific case because of the danger of working there. There has basically not been Western journalists in Syria since 2013. I myself have friends who were kidnapped there because they tried to go and report. And that's one of the major things. And there's been a lot of discussion in the Swedish media and international media about the problem that everyone is depending on the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights. And the thing is that the media that actually do have reporting from inside Syria, who have local journalists and self-taught journalists in general working for them, I mean, they can only work on one side. And it's really difficult to find anyone who don't have their own agenda. So I think that Syria is an extreme example of where it becomes like this.
Yeah. And how about the local media? How do they project?
The local media, and actually the government media, we don't trust even before the war.
So same.
That we don't, from the beginning, everybody knows that. And I think the government even know that it's very weak. You know, they don't trust themselves in media. That's why they decide to change the things by on the land, you know, not talk so much, you know. So they decide to make victory. And I think this is the decision of the government, but they know that they cannot be in competition with even like Middle Eastern media, you know, they know that the weakness they have. And this is something really like positive for the Syrian government. They know exactly themselves really well. They were not like kind of the like Qazafis and the others, which is like they pretend that they are like Americans, but they have no power.
But do they at least report what's happening in general?
Yeah, of course they do. The national TV, they do whatever they best, you know. Yeah. But normally we say the following word, you know, because after experience the war, we can say, we know that the government lied, but the people who ask for change, we find out they are lying 100 times more than the government. Because it's really incredible. For us it was like two choices, which is we don't want that, you know. And for the people, for the media, like most of the activists, which is like Western media, take information from them. They already choose side, and you cannot trust person who takes side. You cannot call him even journalist. They call him journalist, and because journalists should be independent, should not take side of any of the fighters, and they should report about what they see. But those people not there, I call them war activists, I'm not journalists. And I'm really like, I think the Syrian case show up like international media in Syrian case was not professional, you know, at all. Like very famous magazine, even CNN, like even like whatever you want to call it, big names in Western media, even like Swedish national TV, when I saw that, I was just like, I think they was really very weak. Because at least they should say, we are not sure.
Yeah, I agree with
and,
that.
And from time to time, BBC say that. But except the BBC, no one else say media. I don't know, maybe I didn't find maybe some people say I don't follow.
That's it.
Yeah, but it was, yeah.
I think we will go in and out of this topic quite a lot. But what I'd like to wonder, because we are still talking about this, the society of the spectacle and such. And in the late 60s, escaping was a negative, and then you see also see that people are actually living in realities that might be unbearable, or for various reasons they will choose to escape anyhow. And you said something interesting about escape being a sort of a necessity, and for some people it might be a way of avoiding entering sort of actions or patterns that might be negative for themselves and society, and the escape is actually a safety event or something. Could you
elaborate?
Yes.
I mean, this is also a personal opinion, but I think it's for general humanity, because we all tend to go on holiday on tropical life, like we all tend to do things that's escaping our everyday life. And often when you go and do something, just even a holiday, you come back and you feel like a different person, and you've experienced things, you want to change something. And I focus more on, for example, like the Love Hotel in Tokyo. It's not something as far away as going for 2 weeks holiday somewhere, but it's you know, once a month or once every 2 weeks. But the problem is a lot of people get stuck in the escapism. And I gave before the example of the computer games. Some people even died playing computer games because they were there 48 hours without eating, or 68 hours, I don't know. And these types of escapism is, or North Korea, it's not a healthy type of escapism, what's happening there. People should know what they're living and why they're living this way, and not be living in the Truman Show, you know, in a fantasy world that's created for them.